Good evening, all. Welcome to He's Real and He's Listening. I'm your host, Luis Feliciano. And like I do every single Saturday, we're going to invite the Holy Spirit to guide us through everything that we're about to share through our lips. Lord, we thank you so much for allowing us to get here safely, to getting here, my speaker safely here. God, we ask you in this very moment to pour your Holy Spirit upon our lips and our hearts, that everything that we're about to share to the listeners, that is led by the Holy Spirit. We thank you so much, God, for allowing us to do our assignment and to use our voice to speak about your glory and your honor. We ask you to continue blessing us, continue using us, and all this we ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I think we're a couple of minutes there. I apologize for that. I thank God for allowing me another Saturday to be here and sit and ready to use my voice to glorify our God. Like I always do every week, I always like to share a little bit of how my week went. And I had learned through my pastors that it's good to be transparent of things that you go in life. So those that think when you come to Christ that is easy once you come to God, that it's easy to walk and to do God's things. But sometimes when you get attacked by the enemy, it's good for us to be ready. And this week I went through something very... very tough. It was one of them. As a matter of fact, I posted it on Facebook and shared with some of the brothers and sisters. It was one of my toughest walks with Christ. And this is all getting prepared, with the word and also asking advice from others, how to deal with the stuff that I was dealing with. And even with that, the enemy still snuck in there and actually made the old Lou come out. And I say that very strongly to people to understand that just because we look like we are walking in God, we look strong, we write great stuff on Facebook, but sometimes when we go through our challenges, the same way anybody could be weak, I could get weaker. It doesn't matter how strong we look in front of people's eyes, sometimes the enemy, when he's ready to attack you, he's going to do it whether we like it or not. And one of the things that I thank God is this. God had placed me in a church that he had blessed me with many brothers and sisters. And I mean that very strongly, because I know if I would have been any other place and I wouldn't been firm with God or strongly with God and believing strongly in him, I think it was one of those weeks that I was ready to give everything up. And I say that very strongly and very honest. I was ready many don't know this. I was ready not to even do the book club today. I was ready to call my speaker and tell him that we're going to cancel. I was ready to tell Sam that, hey, I'm going to cancel this show today. But when God is in it and you believe very powerfully and when you have awesome brothers and sisters that tell you, that's not you, God called you to be a leader, and you hear those words and encouraging into your heart, it's time to you to make a stand, and you have a choice, or you in or out, like I always share. But I thank God that he placed these brothers in my life that I got up. I'm gonna be honest, I felt deep down, it was like the heavy that I felt way back when I was in the world. I felt like the world had just crumbled, and I'm going to be honest, I didn't know how to get out. I lacked everything. I even turned off my phone, and I thank God that people that know me, they started calling me and started getting worried, and I was like, I just didn't want to be bothered. It's like, it wasn't being disrespectful to them, but it felt so heavy. My heart was hurt. I mean, it's a hurt that I can't explain, but I thank God that when God places an assignment in your hand, one of the things that I had learned through my pastor is that, get up. If you've fallen, get right back up. I'm going to tell you something. The enemy gave me a hit that I fell to the ground. And I thought I was not going to get up. But I thank God for the brothers and sisters that the Lord had placed in my life that they helped me get right back up. And I really praise God for that. And let me tell you something. There's no way I want to go back. I want to continue going forward. That is a promise from the bottom of my heart. And without further ado, my speaker that I'm about to introduce, since day one when we met, I mean, there's no word to explain. We connected, like, we knew each other for years. It's like, it's funny, it felt like we were raised together. I don't know, you know, maybe he'll share that, but it was so weird that we just connected. And the funny thing is that when we met, I even told him, I said, God, man, you remind me so much of one of my brothers, man, because we act the same, we laugh, we share stuff together, we do things together, and one of the beauty is that when we do it together, we enjoy it. And lately, we have become like people are going to laugh at this, like peanut butter and jelly together, or like chocolate and peanut butter, like all these combination, like bacon and egg, we have come into a combination that I enjoy, you know, we enjoy each other's company. And to be honest, I think we stay connected together every single in the morning and the night. We stay connected, and I, to me personally, I need a person like that in my life. I need to stay connected with someone. Like, for instance, when I almost fell this, you know, this weekend, this person was the one that really like was worried, because he knows me. And when you see someone that knows you that deep and knows something's not right, and he continued to get in touch, believe it or not, when I saw the text the next day, that is what made me get up. I said, wow, this brother really knows me deep, and you know, and I thank him for that. He doesn't even know that, but because of him sending that text, I got me back up. I was in the bed like I didn't want to get up anymore. I just wanted to like die in that bed, and I thank God for placing him in my life. And without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to him, and he has become not only as my brother in Christ, but in my heart become like my blood brother. He has been there through thick and thin. He has picked me up when I have fallen, and everything we do together, we do with so much love. And he had taught me, he doesn't know this, but he had taught me how to be a good man of Christ and also a good server. And he has to introduce you, my good brother, Ray Espinal.
God bless you, brother. How are you, man?
God bless you. Doing awesome.
All right. Good to see you tonight,
good
man.
Good to see you.
So I finally get to see your little operation here. This is like underground, you know. But I'm blessed to be here, first of all.
Thank you.
Like to thank my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, for, you know, giving me a great day today. And, you know, allowing me to be here tonight.
Amen.
Yeah, so as you mentioned earlier, I think, we made a connection definitely from day one that you came into Third Day. What's it been now? A couple, 2 years?
3 years.
My God, time flies.
3 years.
But yeah, Lewis, same here. I mean, thank you for those kind words and words of strength as well, because, you know, like you said, and this is a tough walk, you know, so you're coming into church and you see so many people coming in and out, and you know, you always, there are always those special connections that you make, you know, whether it's at work, playing field when you're playing sports, whatever the case is. But our relationship has definitely been a unique, special one since you got to Third Day. So I appreciate you as well. You've blessed my life and in many ways, and your family. So thank you for that. Okay.
Amen.
You know, it's an honor to be here.
Me too. Yeah, you could share the way the show is run, that you could share how you came to the Lord, and how, you know, some of us share in our testimony how we came to Christ, and,
sure.
And what is it that's so powerful, like the name of the show, he's listening.
Mm-hmm.
What did God do for you, or where did he take you out of that you are here today,
well,
serving the Lord?
Well, that's a perfect segue, the name of your show, he's listening, because you know, I my walk with God began as a child, you know. I mean, I'm probably the guy that, you know, most people were. I don't have a story to tell you that I grew up in drugs, that I was in front of abuse, that I, you know, was, you know, surrounded by, you know, as many negatives as a lot of our brothers, you know, have encountered. But, you know, I kind of came from a home, where, you know, mom and dad were there, right? And there's, you know, praise God, they're still together to this day. They've been
Amen.
Together for 43, mm-hmm. on to 44 years.
Praise
and
God.
Thank you, Lord, for that, because he kept it together, not them. But, you know, so I had a kind of a good model at home to look at. You know, my dad was always working. My mom was always home. We grew up in a Catholic background. So, you know, as far as I can remember, we always went to church on Sundays, you know, but I think from the age of 8 years old, I think it was in fourth grade, actually, you know, I became involved in ministry over there. in New York, and you know, I was a altar server. Many people call it an altar boy. So that was kind of, you know, fun as a kid doing that, and all the way to you know, until it was time to go to college. But you know, I always felt like this calling, you know, from God, and right before I went to high school. And you know, looking back at it now, I can tell you that God definitely wanted me to get involved in ministry back then, and I just didn't want to do it. You know, the girls were too pretty in the youth group. You know, I wanted to be around them, and you know, and you know, kind of do life as I knew it. You know what I mean? You know, my parents, you know, try to do their best, and you know, but the Bible says, you know, if you train your child in the ways of God, you know, he will come back. He may be 15, 20 years, but he'll come back. And you know, so I was away from God till about maybe 5 years ago. You know, I believed in him. In fact, my first marriage was, which I got married through church, the Catholic Church, and kind of just went through the whole ritual part. Didn't have a relationship, didn't know about a relationship with, you know, with Christ. It was more of you know, the fear of God, and you know, God was this big, you know, guy that looked like Mr. Clean, you know, looking down at you with, you know, ready to spank you. So that's kind of the image I had of God growing up. And you know, who wants to be around that? You know, you knew Jesus, you knew the crucifixion and all that, but you know, but you know, 5 years ago I gave my life to the Lord. You know, I came to Third Day. I was coming off of a divorce, you know, and a very tough one, and I was brought there by a friend. And you know, went to Third Day. Didn't know what I was getting into. I knew it wasn't a Catholic church, but I, you know, something moved. I guess in me. And after the second visit there, and you know, I felt like I was in the right place. Something fit, you know, as far as the word that was being preached that day. And I gave my life to the Lord that day. And I've been, you know, growing and growing ever since. And I don't know where I'd be if it wasn't for that day.
Wow. What year was it?
That was 2009. I came here July of 2009. And I gave my life to the Lord probably just a couple weeks after. I think it was the second Sunday that I was there.
So you got like...
5 years, a little over 5 years, yeah.
You know what's so amazing? To be honest, since the day I met you into present, mm-hmm. I feel like you were there longer. Like the way I'm serious. It's like, yeah. So we've spoken so many times and we sat down so many times, but to right. hear you saying, wow, you know what's so amazing that you... I mean, now that it's funny that I know you even deeper. It's so weird because the way I wish people would be like you. You know, there's some people that say, "I wish there was another Ray or I wish there was another Lewis." You know what? No, you're unique because Amen. You came to Christ right yeah. that not that long ago. But the way you serve God is like someone that's been serving God like 15, 20 years. I'm saying that with respect. I'm saying that with a lot of love because. If we were to all do like the way you are, the way you serve, and you know, I had learned through you serving, because one of the things that I love about Third Day, and I'm gonna say this very openly with my heart, I love the way many serve God in that church. They do it with so much respect and so much love, yes. But it's because the way our pastors have taught us.
Yes.
You know, and one of the things that I will say that one of the things that I love about you is that the way we stay, you know, you don't know how important that is, but the way we text each other, the way we call each other, the way we come with these ideas together, it's an excitement. But a good thing is that we talk about it, but we also do it. It's not just talking about it. And I feel like many of us, if God places something in your heart, don't be afraid to go forward and do it. You know why? Because yeah. God's going to give you the resource. He's going to give you the people that you're supposed to do it. Don't be afraid. And like I said in the beginning, when I started sharing, you know, you don't know this. Sometimes God places stuff in your hand, and you don't even know the reason, but you follow with God's guidance and do it without questioning. You know why? Because down the line, you're gonna see where it's gonna fit and why.
Amen.
And I'm saying this for a reason. When I tell you, when I went through that pain and I went through those days, what woke me up, and I don't think I told you this, was when I got that text. And the text was, I'm super committed to all the stuff that the church had put in my hand to do. because I know it came from God, and because the way my pastors has brought us up and the way they have taught us is that when you fall, get up no matter what. And I'm gonna tell you this from the bottom of my heart. I was not gonna get up on that bed. I was ready. I'm ready to give up everything up. I was ready to not do the. Like I told you in the beginning, I was ready to do. I was gonna cancel the show. I was gonna. I wasn't even gonna go to church anymore for a while. It just was like a super lockdown. But you know why that happened? Because of my disobedience of not connecting the right way and preparing myself more strongly, because I should know better. Because the enemy will use anything, and I ain't saying that proudly. He will use anything and know your weakness.
That's right.
And once he let that old look come out, he already knew. Like, he probably started laughing. Oh, yeah, I got him again. But when you sent me that text that Pastor Charles wanted security for Wednesday, remember, the next person in line to do that was me.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? So if I didn't get up and do it, then I would be all the stuff that I've been writing on Facebook and all the stuff, encouragement that I gave everybody, I was going to be calling myself a liar. That's the way I felt. So when you said, you know, let me know if you got the stuff ready, and you didn't even know that I was home. I stood home. You know why? Because I was such in bad shape that I couldn't go out there and face the world. Because I know if I would have gone to New York, I would have done something, or somebody would have said something, I would have exploded.
Sure.
So I protected myself, and you know, like saying, God, I gotta stay home. I couldn't go out to the way I was feeling. But when I saw that text, he said, Pastor Charles wants security for the baptism. I got up like in an instant. It's like I'm needing a lie. Oh, I was crying from the day before to the day when you text me that. Mm-hmm. I got up and I wiped my tears and I said, be a man and get up.
Amen.
And I got up, connected the things that we needed for the next day, and I was there. And you saw me. I was still not in good shape, but I said, I'm going to do what I'm supposed to do for God.
Amen. Amen. And that's awesome, because you know, one of the things that's, you know, we always have to constantly remind ourselves is you know, it's not just, and we all know it, you know, but it's also a matter of doing it. The word of God, I mean, I tell you, because remember, I sent you that scripture the other day, and it's actually my life-saving scripture, because, you know, I say clearly, I've been through two divorces, okay? You know, the first one, it's going to be, I guess, 11 years now. I mean, time flies, I guess, almost 11 years. And, you know, it was a very painful one. And, you know, my brother, my blood brother, you know, catching him with my spouse at the time. And then just going through a real tough one just nearly, actually, probably 5 years ago, too, except we tried, I guess, mend the relationship, and that didn't work out. And that ended also very, very ugly. You know, but you know, as you continue to go back, and I don't mean go back to dwell on your past, you kind of to look back at what you've done. I had to kind of take a serious inventory of myself close to about a year ago, maybe December, when I went to the last breakup, which is something that I never expected. It just came out of left field. And you know what, Lewis? I was searching, just like you were the other night. You know, I wanted to stay home, but I knew I had to go to work. I have two kids to support. They live in New York. And, you know, the only thing I knew, there were days that I would read the Word. There would be 3 or 4 days I didn't read the Word. There would be 2 days I would take the Bible and slam it, because I said I was upset at God. I was upset. I said, God, how is it that you love me? How is it that this person I was just with praises your name on Sundays and, you know, and basically, you know, does what they did, you know? And I understand none of us are perfect, but there's a, you know, there's certain expectations that we have, and I could almost sense, you know, after a while of me continuously asking God that question, he said, well, you know, that's because you set expectations, you know, and you should, you know, perhaps be looking at me and looking for my guidance. And sometimes we can get caught up in, yeah, we believe God, we trust his word, we believe his promises and everything, but you know, you really don't take time, we don't take time to pause, and that may be because of life that we're going through, you know, the fast life we live in. And you know, even while you go to church, I mean, you can miss everything that really God is trying to get at. And what I've learned from there is that it's not so much that God doesn't want us to progress, he wants us to progress with him, and we leave him out. Until this day, we leave God out in a lot of things.
Yeah.
Whether you're a believer or, you know, obviously non-believers, it's even worse. But I tell you, I mean, I at the end of the day, what I came back to was the Word of God. Because that's what pulled me out little by little, even during the times that I didn't feel anything. And I'm like, God, I didn't even feel. I read the scripture. I've been, you know, diving into your word today, you know, and I didn't feel anything. I stayed out of church for about 6 weeks from the beginning of November till I think I came back right before Christmas. And I sent Pastor a message and I said, you know, I want to come home because I had a miserable Thanksgiving and a miserable Christmas, you know. And a lot of people can say, you know what, Ray, you kind of had a choice. You could have gotten up. But I said, no, I couldn't have gotten up. I didn't feel like getting up. I didn't feel like seeing anyone. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel like seeing my kids for the purpose of having to look at me and telling them, look, I've now, you know, that old family is gone again, you know, and then the burden of carrying of their pain, because I knew what was coming because I knew their hearts. But again, Lewis, I was ready to give up just like you the other day, and something would not let me give up. And, you know, it's not that we're, you know, this committed, perfect person and that you're reading the Word of God, you know, like God expects us to. But when you are trying and you're constantly trying to be faithful to God, you know, the Holy Spirit, that word rises up in your spirit and it reminds you of God's promise, you know. You know, and obviously, you know, I give all praise and glory to Him because little by little, even during the times that, you know, I wasn't feeling like He was doing anything. But I just continued to, you know, do what I could do, pray, and, you know, and thank God for His grace, because there were days, like I said before, I didn't want to pray and I didn't. You know, it was January, November through January was really hard. I was going to work. I was living what they call the gusano, la vida del gusano, right?
Yeah.
I would get up in the morning, have some breakfast, go to work, come back home, and way back home, just cry every day on my 15-minute drive home. And, you know, whether I was, you know, just breaking and on my way back to recovery, I didn't know. I just felt like that. I felt rejected. I felt, oh my God, it was depression all over again. And I said, God, what went wrong? You know, I mean, but in the back of your mind, inside of you, you kind of know what kind of went wrong, but you're still trying to make sense out of it. And, you know, and I started going to church again, and I remember Pastor Raina coming by me on a Wednesday night. Oh, those Wednesday services. And by the way, if you don't go to a church on a Wednesday night, shame on you, because you should. And if you need a place to go, it's Third Day Worship Center at 1700 Hanover Avenue, Allentown, PA. And the zip code is 18109 for your GPS, so there's no excuse for you not making it. It's at 7, it's bilingual, and we're not a perfect family, but we love Jesus perfectly. So,
amen.
You know, but, and thank God she passed by me that night. Something, you know, the Spirit of God was moving in the house. She came over, and I remember the words that she prayed over me was passion, you know, the passion return.
Wow.
The passion return. And I still didn't feel anything going home that night. I'm like, God, I just got prayed on by my pastors, you know, my spiritual mom and dad. And again, I didn't feel anything, but I'm like, I'm just going to trust whatever it is. And long, but not, you know, not too long after that, I started feeling like I was coming back. You know, I kind of had to go through this period where I had to, you know, the last person I was with, I kind of had to endure that the person moved on and got married, and I had to swallow that fish oil pill, that thick pill, you know. And then I came across 1 Corinthians 10:13, which God says, no temptation, you know, no matter what it is, God will not allow you to take on more than you can bear. So that means that when He had the idea of creating 5'5" Ray many, many moons ago before the foundations of the world, He knew what I was going to go through. He knew how He had to make me and create me and wire me, right, to be able to endure whatever He was going to have me go through for His purpose. And so when I received that word in that way, and I was just reading one day, I felt like this power come into me, I had never felt before. I felt like, kind of when you go into the chiropractor, right, you're trying to get your back straight now because maybe you had a back injury, like something snapped back into place, Lewis. And from that day forward, I just kind of got up, and my mind became all of a sudden clear as I'm looking at you right now, clear as day, because I had this fog going on every day. And he pulled me out. You know, he pulled me out once again. And I said, you know, I said, God, you know, not that I hadn't prayed this to him before and said it, and, you know, I said, let your will be done. It doesn't matter. I don't care if I, you know, if you want me to have a job that pays me $8 an hour, you know, it doesn't matter. I don't care about being a CEO like I used to. And, you know, and then I ended up throwing newspapers at a time that I couldn't find a job. I said, Lord, my life is yours. If on Sundays I'm raising my hand and saying that I'm proclaiming that my life is yours, then show me how I can act like it. You know, not, I don't want to be a guy that just says it. I want to back up what I'm saying, not to prove anything to anyone, but, you know, to honor him. And so to me, every day I get up now, Lewis, I have a purpose, man. Like, I get up in the morning, I know what I'm going to do that morning. I don't know if I'm going to go to the gym. I don't know if I'm going to go. And, you know, a lot of people maybe just read that, and I want to be able to use everything that I go through to be able to help somebody else out. Because somebody else's posts and texts,
yes,
you know, although I didn't, you know, make it a public thing, but those things help me. You know, encouraging messages from you, you know, and other brothers and sisters from the house. I mean, those things, you keep working. And a lot of people, you know, no matter what you're going through, no matter what you're going through, you still read Facebook. You read the messages. You know, I mean, people don't, come on, you know, you got to be, let's be real here. And those things were helping me. You know, I was still from afar watching my third day family. And I was missing the heck out of everybody. But I couldn't go back to the house unless I felt like, I mean, I knew that the only way I would return, you know, would be if I was going to be effective for God. I didn't want to be there and just be a sourpuss. I don't want anybody to feel sorry for me because, you know, I needed to take ownership for what I, you know, the decision that I made, you know. But, you know, praise God that he got me through it. And you know what? I'm not here to tell you that I'm 100% healed, but I'm real close to it because there's time that the enemy rises up. You know, I'll have these thoughts. I mean, someone broke my heart and you know. But then, you know, I kind of, you know, we have to understand that none of us have arrived. It will never arrive. Jesus died for everything, for any kind of sin you could come up with right now. And then the final part that of what helped me, you know, kind of get an understanding, you know, to help me heal was what Jesus said on the cross. You know, he said, Father, forgive them, for they not know what they do. So just because you go to church and you kind of sometimes we kind of put a pressure on one another. Oh, yeah, there's certain basic things you should know as a Christian not to do. But our understanding level is different. And this is not to demise or say that anyone is less martyr, because we're all unique and we're all precious to God. And but subconsciously, people, you know, may not get things the way you receive them. You know, I mean, and that could be part of God's plan too. So, in understanding that, I was able to find a way to forgive that person because I held on, man. I was just like, you know, what I went through before, and I was just kind of in my mind. And I was battling myself. But, you know, it really came down to me to where God wanted me to be. He wanted me in the pit, face to face with him, and look at myself, look at my life, and say, you know what? All right, God, I mean, here, I give up. It's all you. Obviously, I don't know what I'm doing. I think I know what I'm doing. I'm a good person, but that doesn't mean anything to him. Right. So it was just it was a matter of total surrender. And, you know, I mean, I battle those things every day. You know, I mean, I have family that ask me, how do you do it? You know, you're a man. You've been married twice. You know, you're single now. How do you do it? And, you know, and I say to them, and what they're referring to is the intimate part. You know, the sexual, but I have nothing to hide, man. I say I'm a man. You know, I was intimate with two women. You know, I mean, you know how it is, Lewis. And you know, I had some battles at the beginning, man. You know, but I had to give that to God. And everything is impossible on our own strength, but nothing's impossible with Him. And you know, and you still battle those things every day because you know we're flat. You know, because of the flesh. That's part of us is that. But but in continuing to look for him, you know, he is faithful. His word is faithful, forever faithful, because he says, seek and you shall find. And he doesn't tell you what you seek, but he's telling you that whatever you need, to seek, you're going to find it through him. And you seek the kingdom of God, and everything else I'll be given to you. So there's nobody like him.
Amen. Mm.
I give all the glory and honor to him.
You know, when Ray was sharing in that moment that he walked away a little bit, you know, from church and from me, one of the things that I had learned is the way that I had learned through Third Day and through my own life, I've always been this way. I'm a very open, very honest person. I don't sugarcoat nothing, and Brother Ray knows that. I'll tell you how it is, how I feel. And when he
yes, did, you do, Lewis.
And when that happened in his life at that moment, one of the things that Pastor Charles said the other day when he introduced him, he's an overcomer, and I said that from the bottom of my heart. He's definitely an overcomer, and I pray and I hope and pray that many men will see this as what Brother Ray went through, because at those moments I felt hurt when he walked away, because I told him this. He's sitting right here. I said I felt like I had my partner next to me, you know, with a shield and a sword, and he dropped it and left me by myself, and I felt hurt, and I told him this. It wasn't something to hide, and he looked at me. I said, but then when he came back and he said, Louis, I'm back, I'm ready to this, and you know what, since that day that he came, and all the way, I didn't accept that. I was still hurt. He knows that I treated him a little cold. I don't even remember that. I would look at him,
you
and
mean, bro.
And
you
I would, mean, dude, and I would turn my face like I don't even if I could put my hand out. But you know what, he knew but we continued working together. And let me tell you something, as he sit here in front of me, he's one of those men that will give his all. He'll give his shirt off his back to anybody that needs help. And I say that from the bottom of my heart, because there have been times that I almost fought, and he's right there. He'll stick his hand out, he'll lift me back up, go, he'll tell me, Louis. And one of the beauty that he does when I call him and we speak over the phone, and I know we learned this through Third Day, is that he prays over the phone for me. And I find that so powerful, because when he prays, he doesn't notice. I close my eyes. I don't care where I'm at. I'll stop. And he'll insert that prayer, and that will continue giving me the strength to continue to go forward. And I advise brothers out there, you know, to find. And I explain this clearly now, because I used to say, go find an accountable partner or find a spiritual partner. But I also got to be careful the way the pastor taught me is find a person that's going to help you to give you strength, not just anyone.
Yeah.
In other words, if you are depressed, don't go find another person that's depressed.
That's right.
If somebody's hurting, don't go find another person that's hurting. Get someone that's going to get you out of that place in the moment that you're in.
That's right.
It's very important. And my brother Ray sitting here and speaking, you know, I mean, me, I don't know how to explain it, but it's like when we do stuff together, we enjoy it. Pastor Charles put us together, and it was a reason. And when God did that with him, it's like, you know what? The enemy tried to break us up. Forget who's laughing last.
That's right.
God,
that's right.
He said, no, you are meant to be together. And I feel in my heart that the best is yet to come. I could feel it.
Amen. I believe that as well, brother. I believe that as well. And it's interesting you say that. If Pastor had put us together a few years back, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, when I left, you know, in my heart, I left, but it was for a temporary time. But I actually was planning to come back, you know, with the person that I was trying to kind of mend the relationship with. But, you know, Third Day is, you know, everything that I've learned and everything that I will continue to learn, you know, will be, you know, will be because of everything that I've learned through Pastor Charles and Pastor Raina.
Amen, yes.
You know, I mean, everything from, you know, from when I started to go there the first day until now. I mean, I pull up messages, old stuff like that. I mean, I'm, you know, I just, the one thing I knew when I took the time off was, I said, you know what, I wasn't to the point where I was suicidal. I wasn't going crazy like that. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't going, cuckoo for Cocoa Pops, Lewis, you know what I mean? But, you know, at the same time, I said, you know what, I think I had sent some texts to the guy. I said, look, I'm okay. I'm away right now. I needed to get myself back on track. I said, you know what, no matter who I speak to, pastors, you know, brothers in Christ, I said, at the end of the day, there's an issue here. I have to deal with it. I have to look at myself in the mirror. Lewis, I don't know if you've ever done, one of the hardest things to do when you're going through something is to actually look at yourself in the mirror. And I couldn't look at myself in the mirror because I was like disgusted about my life, the decisions that I had made, what I had allowed in my life.
Wow.
And I was really angry at myself for a while. But I knew that I knew enough of what I had learned you know, through Third Day about God, you know, and the type of God that we serve, that that at the end of the day, you'll always have the inkling inside of you that you knew that something wasn't right.
Mm.
You know, you just kind of wanted to do your own thing. Not my own thing. I wanted to just try to make things right from the perspective of not breaking up my family. I wanted things to work out. But even that, God's ways are higher than our ways, the Bible says, right? So we can think that everything is looking according to God's character and principles, but it might not be what his plan was. So, you know, it's hard, and he breaks you through, you know, through, he takes you through a process where he's breaking you, and nobody likes that part. Mm-hmm. That part hurts, you know, and when you've gone through it, you know, a couple of times, you know, it's funny because the other day somebody stopped me and asked me, say, listen, who's your favorite character? Who's the character in the Bible that reminds you of what you've been through, right? And I said, oh my God, do I really have to answer that? Because it was a bunch of them, you know, it was Job. You know, Job lost everything, lost his house, and that happened to me in the first go round. You know, and then there was Samson. You know, although he had an issue with women, but the point about bringing about Samson is that Samson was not connected to the right type of woman, and he knew it. You know, he disrespected his parents. Didn't want him to be connected with that Philistine woman, and he knew it. But he wanted to go with what he wanted to do. So, and by the way, Samson is the man with the most famous haircut in the world. I don't know if you know that, but yeah. So I mean, so many things. I mean, to be honest with you, Lewis, just ready to throw in the towel. I was even considering what Paul said. Paul said, "You're better off not to get married." I really considered that. I even said to the Lord in a prayer during that time when I surrendered. I said, "Lord, if you don't want me to be married no more, I'm good with that." You know. You know, but, you know, it somehow, you know, that seemed to change. But, I mean, I was really dead serious about it. I think God knows when you're really saying something to him, when you really have surrendered, when he says, all right, now I'm ready to come in and try to fix things. And he's still fixing things, you know, I mean. But my job is to be able to, every day, I have a responsibility when I open my eyes in the morning, you know, is to praise him for doing that. And number two, you know, just trying to walk, you know, align in line to his word and just take it from there, you know. There's things that you mess up on every day and things that you learn, you know, and, you know, and I guess, you know, that's part of what I have a responsibility. Like I said, I have to be the best dad. I have to be the best brother in Christ. You know what I mean? The best guy doing his job at work, you know, just being the best that I can be. So, because God expects it of me, and then everybody that's around me expects that. So, you know, because I might go home tomorrow, right? I might go, God may run, the trumpet may play tomorrow, man. And I'm like, I got to try to be in as right standing as I can. So, I take that seriously because I don't know when I'm going back.
Amen. Yeah. Well, I know you've been a super blessing in my life, that's
Amen.
For sure.
Amen. Likewise.
I'm going to give a shout out to someone. I'm going to shock her because something that she wrote to me and did in the moments when I was going through my painful 2 days. And it shocked me, you know, like you stated something when you were sharing about how important it is to write encouraging word on Facebook. And when you were sharing it, she just popped into my head because You have no idea. Many men, I think that you don't know how much people you are touching, and I did know, but when this person texted me something, it super like blew my mind, and the sister is Sister Shirley, she saw me on Wednesday, right, when I came to church, and she stood in front of me and she went, she gave me this this blessing, you know, like she said, I want to call you Theo, spiritual Theo, and I thought she was joking, but you know what? With that text she sent me on Wednesday, she wasn't joking because she got in front of me and she said, Theo, what happened? Mm-hmm. I haven't seen you posting anything. Because I told you, on that day I closed the Facebook completely.
I said that.
And what I read, what she wrote to me, it really brought me to tears. And I was reading it when I was walking in New York City as I was doing an assignment. And when she wrote that, it touched my heart so deeply, because here I was thinking, I ain't touching the enemy. Put stuff in your head right away. He'll say, your encouraging words doesn't mean nothing. I don't even know why you keep writing those things. But you know what? That's the lie of the enemy. I rebuke him in the name of Jesus. But when I read what Sister Shirley wrote to me, it was like it just, my jaw dropped. He said, "Dude, I don't know what's going on, but I know something is wrong. But me personally," and this is a leader from the church, this is what she wrote. She said, "But I need those encouraging words myself," mm-hmm. "even though you don't believe it or not." Mm-hmm. "I need strength every day." When I read that, it was just, wow. Here I am thinking, the enemy making me selfish, thinking it's all about Lewis. But you know what? No, it's not all about Lewis.
Right.
It's all about those people out there. People don't understand. Facebook, to me, is a tool to use to glorify God. Not only to glorify God, but also to give people encouraging words and to let them know that's the only way we're going to get through things in life is by having God first. I don't care what anybody say. You could try, but I'm going to tell you something right now. It's not going to work. It's a must. Put everything you do, any plan, put God first. And I guarantee you, he will bless us. So, Sister Shirley, thank you so much. And it's an honor for me being your Theo. And I praise her. And she's an awesome woman of God. And I love her and her family very much.
Amen. And by the way, how many nephews and nieces do you have? Oh my. You got like more kids than something. Jerry's kids, man.
You want to hear something strange that you asked that?
Yeah.
All that was not asked from me. It's weird. All those things that you see people saying, uncle, daughter. You know what's so funny? You want to know where that came from? And it's going to shock the world, and it's probably going to shock you. That came from a prayer when I prayed 10 years old.
Wow.
Because of my growing up, I did not have no connection with no family. Mm. My family, even though they don't understand, but it was so dysfunctional that they did not believe in connecting with family.
Right.
To order me to see uncles or aunts, it would take years, like, to my dad to get out of his comfort, like his little comfort zone, go visit an aunt in the Bronx. One time out of every year.
Wow.
One time. So my prayer when I was 10 was, please God, place in my life people that I could trust and they would understand what the definition of uncle, aunt, and all that. And little by little, God was throwing people my way. And I wasn't asking. They would give me that privilege and that honor.
Mm-hmm. Wow, that's awesome.
Isn't that weird? And that's when awesome. The people call me that, I take that from deep from the heart, because I never saw myself to be respected as that. I never saw myself as a good uncle. I never saw myself as a father, as a grandpa, and even as a husband. But God knew my heart, and he knew the kind of person I am, that God had given me that gift.
Amen. That's awesome. And you know what? And that's one thing that I've also, you know, the family connection at Third Day is, I mean, there's not enough words to describe. I don't have any family members in Pennsylvania. I mean, my kids left, my first wife in 2006, I guess they left, 05. I stayed here. You know, and back then, I mean, my family was like, oh, why are you staying here? Everybody's home in New York and Jersey, whatever. But and obviously, I'm my second wife after that. But I don't have any family members here. But one thing is that Third Day has been that family, that rock, you know, that rock. Yes. And so I found that no matter what's happened to me, you know, in these last 5 years, you know, they're still there. And I appreciate it. And I give, you know, I don't even know. I mean, to Pastor Charles and Pastor Raina for just having those doors open there. You know, a lot of times, it's disappointing, you know, when you see and you hear and you see people come and go. And I understand that's a church, kind of a famous thing in the church, but it shouldn't be that way. Because what happens is there's so many misunderstandings. People come in with whatever they're, you know, they've learned, you know, from the world and their culture. And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, misunderstandings, you know. But
yes.
But one thing that people have to understand is that consistency is a key. You know, it's almost like when you get a job, you know, maybe you get a job that you're looking forward to and then you start it and then, you know, something happens where you start not liking the job anymore. But you know that if you leave the job, you're not going to have provision for that much longer. You have to start looking all over again. But if you could just hang in there, you know, if you could just hang in there and do the best job you can, then good things are going to come out of that. So the same thing works, you know, when you commit to a church. And that's one thing that our society has forgotten about, is about commitment. You know, whether it's marriage, whether it's, you know, friendship, a job, you know what I mean? Or, you know, let's say you made up your mind because you want to go after this certain goal. Just go after it. Just, you know, just know that there's going to be challenges. But every day, you know, you have to overcome it, and you can overcome it, because greater is he that lives in you than he that serves in the world, that lives in the world, right?
So, you know what I love you doing, and I'm gonna give you praise for that. Sometime, I don't know if you feel this way, and you could, you know, you could let me know. sometime since day one, since there's going to be 3 years in third day. And one of the things that sometimes I feel like I overdo, and I'm going to continue. I really don't care what anyone say. People think that you're kissing up. Right. But what I love what you keep sharing is that talking about our godly parents, and I'm talking about Pastor John, Pastor Reina. And I say that very strongly because here goes why I'm saying that. I've been there 3 years. And don't forget, I'm going to be 52 years old in November.
You're that young?
I'll be 52 years old, but that's the reason why I'm saying that. In all those 40, in almost 40 something years,
right.
I never in my life, and I'm saying that, underlying that word never, saw myself where I'm at today.
Amen.
Who gave me that encouragement to become who I am today? God used my pastors to become the man that I am today.
Amen.
This show right here, if I would have been taught what Pastor Charles, Pastor Rennie had taught me in those words in those 3 years, I won't be sitting here doing this, hosting this show. Here goes another one. I will not be having a book club in my house Saturday like the way I've been doing it. Why? Because one of the things I love about Pastor John, Pastor Renner, what they do not only with me, but through others is this. They encourage you to become what God has called you to do.
That's right.
They will help you rise up. I know there's people like this that they, to me, that's not of God. If somebody's talking about like rising up about themselves and you know what? I don't want to see that guy grow. And you already know he has something special.
Right.
They'll try to keep that person down.
Yeah.
But the difference between what our godly parents do is that they will rise you up to become what God knows that you can do.
Amen.
I don't know if you know that, but
that
it's not.
Absolutely
and
right.
You don't have to have a background like the word deeply, like knowing from the Bible to the back. You don't have to have this big long sheet of college. You don't have to believe.
Right.
No. If they see your heart and know who you are, they will help you rise. And that I love because look what God has done with me.
Amen.
Look what God has done with you.
That's right. Amen to that. And you know, you hit on that point. That's very powerful. You said about the fact that sometimes people misinterpret and think you're kissing butt.
Mm.
It's biblical because we have to. The Bible says we're to honor our shepherds, right?
Yes.
They are the ones that, you know, God was the one that made up authority. You know what I mean? Government. What do you guys think that idea came from? That was ordained by God. Okay, and so people don't, I think, lose sight of that or choose to. And what the only thing I could tell people about that is, you know, and we must all come to agreement on this because it's, first of all, you know, isn't it funny, Lewis, how we as humans, we're always like, we're dynasty aliens come to the earth, right? But what we don't realize is we are the aliens. Mm-hmm. We don't belong here. We're just here visiting. Mm-hmm. So we're the actual aliens, all right? So if you're waiting for an alien out there, he ain't coming. You are the alien, brother, sister. But we, you know, we've been assigned to be here, okay, by Almighty God. And then he's put people above us to guide us and lead us, kind of like our parents when we were kids, right? And so that clearly just tells you right there that it's not about you.
Mm-hmm.
It's about his ultimate plan.
Mm-hmm.
He's using you to be able to fulfill his work,
mm-hmm.
you know, for such a time as this. You know, maybe you and I couldn't have talked to you know, people back in the 60s or 70s, you know, we're dealing with a lot more deeper issues now. And so God has put us on the earth at this time so that we can make an impact on today's brothers and community and so forth. So people have to understand that it's not about you, you know, and that's one of the things that, you know, in this walk I've had to learn. It's like, it's almost like God is telling you, you know what? I know the life you lived, whether it was drugs, whether you grew up with no dad, whether you were raised by your grandmother. And I pray that someone out there receives peace over what I'm about to say. But God knows all things, right? He's omnipresent. And so therefore, if you came into this world through wedlock, that's part of God's plan for your life. And God wants you to use that story. He wants you to succeed so that you can use your testimony, preach your testimony to someone that is going through that, that's coming up behind you somewhere, to be able to empower them. Because there's nothing you can do, you know, when you have God by your side.
Mm.
You know, God's not saying you're not going to cry. He's not going to say you're not going to break. He's not saying you're going to be broke for a while. He's saying, just hang on to me and keep and to my promises, and I will get you through. So as long as you know that, or can get that understanding deep in your spirit, in the crevices of your soul, that you are not here for you, you're here for Him, then I think we'll begin to have a better understanding of really who we are and what we're supposed to do. You know, and I think we get caught up in everything that we've learned. You know, we have to unlearn it and learn. It's almost like, it's perfect example. You know, the other night we had baptism at church. That was an awesome night, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, it was.
We had some new brothers that came to God that night and renewed in spirit. But it's like you're born again. So you're making a decision that whatever thoughts you had, you know, whatever corrupted, my thinking is if it doesn't align with the Word of God, if you, whatever, no matter what you're thinking, it's then corrupted thinking. If it doesn't align with God's Word, so to me, you have to make that decision. Okay, whatever, however I've been, I did it all wrong, obviously, because I'm here surrendering my life to Christ, right? So therefore, let me start again. Is it going to be easy? Like you said before, no, but you surround yourself around those people. And we are so blessed that we have Pastor Charles and Pastor Raina. And so that's why it is important for people to know that, you know, and people may have an understanding, oh, we honor the pastors, this, this and that. It's biblical, you know. It's the kingdom way. And that's another thing that we have to learn as believers is that, you know, we have to understand what God's initial plan was for us, you know, before the fall of man, was He was bringing the culture of heaven to earth, right? And because of Adam's sin, obviously, we lost that connection, you know, or that, you know, He lost that, but He came back to redeem us.
Right.
If you think about it, the only being that God... Now, when you talk about redeem, you're talking about that means that you once had something and you're trying to get it back. You know, remember, He kicked out Satan and He never took Satan back. So we are precious to God and we have to remember that. And so, you know, we have to keep mind into that God. We're supposed to be living here with a kingdom mindset, you know, and this is about a royal family, the Bible. And we have to adjust our ways of thinking to His ways of thinking, and the only thing it all starts with the Word of God. It's a personal relationship. So it's interesting because these last, I would say, probably 7-8 months, and even before that, I mean, it was a lot of time by myself. I'm a guy that's not used to being by himself all the time at home. You know, I'm used to being with kids around and family, but I realized that that's what God really wanted, and you know. And sometimes you'll say, oh, I pray in the morning, or I spend time with God. But yeah, but you sound like you're satisfied, but is it satisfying the Father?
Exactly.
You know, He may not be satisfied, and He'll do whatever it takes to get you to that point. And so I stress that, and I stress that, especially to men out there that, you know, you've got to become, to me, a bookworm. You know, you've got to be able to know more. And I think that the reason that a lot of men maybe don't read as much is because as men, we have this pride thing and we think that we do know it all. Well, we don't know it all, you know. And so we have to come to that place of submission so that we can understand that and take forth. And then the sisters out there have to understand the responsibility that God has put on us. Because remember, when God gave the first word, it was to Adam. He told Adam, you know, regarding the tree, not to eat from there. He never told Eve that, right? So, you know, in essence, you know, a lot of people are like, well, why didn't God stop little skinny Eve? You know, why didn't God stop that little woman from, you know, messing up everything? Because God will not violate His word. You know, He had given the word to Adam, and so it was Adam's responsibility. So we have to, you know, again, a lot of times I feel that we all, God, this applies to me. God's been taking me this road this year in 2014. He's been taking me back to the beginning. I've been stuck in the book of Genesis for some reason. I keep going back to it. And it's because God says, it's not that I don't want you guys to advance or grow, but I want you guys, I want to be there with you. This is my plan over your life. And until you get it, I'm going to just allow you to keep tripping.
Wow, that's a lot of awesome, awesome, like Pastor Trump has made a lot of awesome nuggets there. And one of the things that I will say to anyone that's listening is that if someone has done something powerful in your life and you haven't thanked that person, this is your chance to do it. Go and say thank you, because sometimes they like to hear that. We may not know, but when you give a person they gratitude what they have done for you, that will be such a blessing in their life. Not only that, will pick them up and also to continue doing for the next person. So I advise you as your brother in Christ, and I pray we'll say the same thing. You know, go say thank you. It doesn't hurt, because it's a blessing to them and also to yourself. And I thank God for that. And wow, this has been unbelievable. I thank God for allowing us to sit here and to share the beauty that what God has done with us in our life. And I thank God that I didn't went insane. And I thank God for all the people that He puts in my life every day. And like Ray was saying, you know, I thank God for the church that he has put a church in my life that He knows that I needed to maintain myself strong. You know, and I advise you, you know, continue those that like to write encouraging words on Facebook, do it. Because believe it or not, while you're writing, you're picking another person up, because they could be going through something, and while you write, at that moment, they'll read it, and they'll wake them up right at that moment, whatever they're going through, because it happened to me. I read what Brother Ray, Sam, or Uni, or no, anybody, all my brothers and sisters, that when they write something on there, I love it, because I read it, and it connects, and I wake up at the moment, because none of us are perfect. Only God is. And sometimes I could feel hurt at the moment. I could be going through something, and I just go on there and I read, and I'm going to take something that's going to help me to pick myself up through the guidance of God using those, because I know it's all God's doing. The way He sometimes writes stuff, and you read it, be like, man, how did they know? And it's all God, you know, looking out for you. And that's what I love about Jesus, you know. He looks out for His children.
Yeah, it's funny that you say that, Louis. One of the things that I was just thinking about is that, you know, you share that when people post, it's important for us. Every person that you encounter during the day counts, matters. They matter to God, so they should matter to you. Mm. It's not that we can get involved and, you know, be the savior to all these people, but, you know, everyone's testimony, no matter how weird it sounds, no matter how funny it sounds, it's really not funny. It's something that person went through. Mm. It's something that cost that person a lot of pain or grief, or they lost family members or whatever it was, finances. So it's important for us to look at them through the eyes of God.
Amen.
Because the last thing each of us likes when someone's kind of hears a testimony, and you have like people, you know, kind of celebrating, or because it sounded, you know, totally foreign to them. But everyone counts. Everyone that you see living counts, man. So,
amen.
And Jesus said in the second commandment, you know, you have to love your neighbor like yourself.
Amen.
So you gotta love him as much. And you practice that every day, man. It ain't easy, because some of us are real funny out there. But, you know, we're funny, you and I, too.
As I see, I think we got 1 minute.
All right.
I want to thank Brother Ray Espinal so much for coming and committing to share his testimony. It was very powerful. And if I were to title his testimony, what he shared today would be The Man Overcome and Came Back and Stood Strong for Christ. Because he had taught me a lesson not to fall down and stay down. You know what? Get up, stick that chest out, be a man, and go do what God has called you to do. And that's love that for him. And he taught me a lesson. And I thank him from the bottom of my heart. Thank you, Brother Ray, for coming and sharing your testimony with us. And like I said in the beginning of the show, he is real and he is listening. Thank you, Brother Ray.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me, man. Kill it. I'm talking power. There's power. Power is high.